Hi there, welcome back to another Retro Rahalastapa. This time I think it's Miles Jupp. Now I've said that, I'm not even sure it is, but hopefully it is. The actual new ones will be starting again next week, so I don't know if this might be the last retro one for a while. We'll fill in any gaps. Or there might be one next week if it takes more than a week to get the first one up. We'll see. So you can come and see those. Go to the LeicesterSquareTheatre.com and you can buy tickets to see most of them. The one on the 1st is sold out with Bob Mortimer. The one on the 15th with Robert Webb and Louis Theroux is sold out. And the final one with Limmy is sold out. Got Johnny Vegas on the 22nd of June. Emma Kennedy on the 8th of June. Mark Watson and Robin Ince on their 29th of June, and Bridget Christie on the 13th of July. There will be more to come. There'll be another guest on the 1st of June as well. I haven't yet booked anyone, but we'll see who that is. And very exciting to be back with that. I'm also at the Leicester Square Theatre over August and September doing all 12 of my shows, the 11 existing ones and a brand new one. I'm sort of starting to regret that. But hopefully it'll be all right. So you go to LeicesterSquareTheatre.com and you can take part of those. And also, if you want to get your name in next year's tour programme for the new show, which is called Happy Now, go to justgiving.com/happynow and donate at least £15. You get your name in the programme, you send me your address and I'll send you a programme. The more you donate, the bigger your name will appear in the programme. You get a limited edition signed programme for doing that, and probably some prizes will be randomly selected for people who've donated as well. And all your money for that goes to Scope. I know I've been asking for a lot recently, and I appreciate if you've given anything at all. If you can't afford to give anything at all or don't want to give anything at all, you don't have to. Enjoy this retro Rahalastapa for free, my friends, my fan friends. Goodbye. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Leicester Square Theatre. Please welcome a man who, if you heckle him, or even if you don't, he'll hit you with an electrified tennis racket. It's Richard Herring! Thank you! Thank you very much. Oh, you're much better than last week's audience already. Hey, get it? Welcome to... Every time. I love it. Every time. So, welcome to Richard Herring's Leicester Square Theatre podcast, or as all the cool kids are calling it, Rahalastapur. Oh, you're good. Even better than last week. Had to. So, how many times do you think I can do it before no one laughs? We're here with a fantastic crowd. There's a lady who got electrocuted. Ruth, was it? It's good that I remember your name, because it would be rude to electrocute you and not know.
I don't remember yours, though.
You don't remember mine? Well, you probably don't remember anything after that. After last week. And who's this you're with? What's your name? It's your daughter. I was going to say sisters. There's an obvious lie. What? Because you look much older than her. Slam! It's a triple whammy. He's done it. What's your name?
Sarin.
Sarin, like the poison. Yeah, named after the poison. Sarin, like Lauren, like the malt loaf. I'm guessing you've had all this throughout your whole life. I'll try and think of an original one. Like Soren Bonk, the previous lead singer of the band Six Day Riot. Ever had that one before? Thank you. I think that was his name. So check it out on Wikipedia. Fact fans, what do you do for... Are you a student or are you...
A student here.
You're a student here at the Leicester Square Theatre. We're, in a way, we're all students. I'm the professor, but I'm allowed to have sex with the students. Is that all right with you, Mum? Yes, that's fine. Sorry, what was that?
Not Sinead O'Connor.
You're not Sinead O'Connor. You're not Sinead O'Connor, so your daughter can fuck who she likes. If she wants to fuck a disgusting, fat old man whose legs don't really work because he's just run a half marathon, you could do that. You could do that. Your mum allows you. I just want you to know that. But... No, I don't think she wants to. So let's have a look at her embarrassed face, though. There we go. And that's the mum. That's the mum who should be taken in social services. Are you related to these people?
I am. My sister.
You're her aunt. You're her aunt. You're her sister. That's good. Good. What's your name?
My name is Lucy.
Your name's Lucy. And what do you do for a living, Lucy?
I'm a producer.
You're a producer of what?
Documentary.
I'm at them. Can't get. Oh, I could do voiceovers. And here we. What kind of documentaries did you do?
I work for Al Jazeera, so internet.
You work for Al Jazeera. So you're kind of used to seeing the old electrocuting people just being electrocuted.
And here we are. Are you pro-Al-Qaeda or anti-Al-Qaeda? Personally speaking, or you're not allowed to say.
Oh, yeah.
for saying you're anti-Al-Qaeda. So, I'm a terrible man. I'm off. I was going to do a voiceover for you, but then I realised, you know, it will just get worse. I was going to audition. Could you think I could ever work for Al Jazeera?
Very fine.
Yeah, they seem to take anyone on. it's where people go to die, isn't it? Old David Frost, eh? That was a David Frost joke there. We'll cut that out. I'm a terrible person. I'm just a terrible person. You can sponsor me, by the way, for the... Did I mention that for the run I did 2 weeks ago now? Go to ukvirginmoney.com/Richard Herring and you can sponsor, and that money will go to Scope, which is fantastic. You can get T-shirts now as well of the show from richardherring.cottoncart.com. You can get Shrek T-shirts, everything. All the old stuff that I don't do anymore. I was going to talk about... when I was in Armenia, I'd forgotten about this, but I had my fortune told by an old Armenian woman we had to travel for hours out into the countryside, and there was this woman, and she melted wax over your head into a bowl, luckily, a bowl of water, and then she would read your fortune from the shapes of the wax that went into the bowl. And the first thing she said to me it was translated, but she said to me, had an accident 2 days ago? And I said, no, I didn't. And she said, was it 2 weeks ago? I said, no. 2 months ago? I said, no. She said, it's 2 years ago? I said, no, I haven't. Because I don't have many accidents. And she said, there's definitely an accident with a number two. And surely that's happened. That's happened to us all, that just, doesn't it? Ruth, just sometimes you've had a night out. You think it's going to be one thing, it's something else. But it was, everything she said was wrong. She's talking about next door neighbours, everything was. I was really disappointed because I don't believe in fortune telling, but I kind of wanted to go and then be leaving shaking, going, how did she know? Everything was wrong. She said that three people lived next door to me, and that wasn't true. And then she said, you don't believe in fortune telling, do you? Which was correct, so she got one thing right. And she said, you're the kind of person who doesn't light candles in church. And I said, that is correct. She was on a running run of form now. And then she got really, it was like it turned really nasty, going, you're a spiritually bankrupt person. You're floating in an ocean of despair. You have no spirit. There is a saint wanting to look after you, but you won't take his advice. So it kind of turned quite dark. Like the wax was angry with me. And I thought, you know, I just said that I didn't light candles in church. You'd think the wax would like me, wouldn't you? So I don't murder its cousins. Other people are burning up wax willy-nilly. So it's a bit spooky, but that was great. But apparently there's a saint looking after me. I don't know which one. That would have been useful information. Anyway, that's apropos of nothing. So I tell you about, I thought the number two thing would get a laugh. Should have left it there. Cut that out along with the David Frost. A lot of this is ad-libbed, you have to understand. And I am an awful... It just shows the heart that I am an awful person. I think I've warmed you enough up for our next guest. I've got them on a tide of excitement. He is probably best known as the weatherman who appears in the TV in a back shot of one of the Harry Potter films, Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix. He was also a shoe salesman in Revolver. Will you please welcome Miles Jupp, ladies and gentlemen? That's what he's best known for. He's coming through here. Maybe he isn't. Oh, he's... No, there he is. Miles Jupp. There, you've come. You've come in. Pick up your microphone. There's Miles Jupp there.
Was that the right place to come through?
That in the middle, yeah. It seemed to take a long time.
Well, I panicked.
To Eric Morecambe.
Yes. Well, I dare say. I just assumed that I would be coming in there, so I sort of walked into a pillar and then... I sort of thought that can't be. Maybe it's an elaborate trick. It's the sort of way this podcast works, is a series of confusing sight gags. And what would be wrong with that?
Nothing would be wrong with that. It would be fantastic. So do you have many memories of your work on the Harry Potter set?
Yes.
Yeah. Good.
Yeah.
Because that's what most people... To be honest, it's what Chris Evans' son is interested in as well.
Is it?
He's interested in a lot of things that I'm interested in about you. He asked, how was it being... Not what was it like? How was it being in Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix? Is his question.
Well, it was an enormous, enormous privilege. What happened? When I first moved to London, about 2006, I think I had an agent, and she would send me to. I still have this agent. Upsetting's happened. And you have these things with general meetings when you go and meet a casting agent, and you say, "Hello, this is what I look and sound like, and these are the sort of things that I'd love to do one day." And so I went to this place in Twickenham, and it was a really hot day, really humid day, and I thought, God, I don't know how. Oh, God, this is going to be embarrassing. I'm going to be so sweaty when I get there. And I sort of tried to find sort of light clothing and linen and stuff. And I got off the train at St. Margaret's, and I was absolutely... Sweat was pouring down me. And I thought, God, this is dreadful. I'm going to dry myself up in the gents. And I went into the meeting, and I was dry when I went into the meeting. And she started chatting to me, and I started really, really sweating. I thought, oh, God, this is embarrassing. I wonder, maybe she hasn't noticed it. And then she suddenly went, I know you've only just come here for a chat, but would you mind awfully auditioning for the Harry Potter film while you're here? And I didn't actually have anything else on that day, and I was like, yeah, all right, let's stick something on tape. I was very excited, obviously, and then they got this thing, so my agent's saying, yeah, they want you to play a weatherman. I said, is there a weatherman in Harry Potter? I've not read Harry Potter. She went, yeah, there's a weatherman in it. They want you to play the weatherman. So the script's all top secret, so you can't see it. So I go into this place, which is in Leicester or somewhere, and I get there, and they go, right, you're playing the weatherman. And what's happened is it's a story device, and there's some terribly hot weather, and the weatherman is sweating very, very heavily. And that's what it was. I was going, it's hot on this screen, and they were sort of squirting as much water on me, and I had sort of preset sweaty underarms. So actually, that incredible... poor homeostasis stood me in good stead that day.
It sounds like they'd be annoyed, though. I think they only booked you because they thought, that man is really sweaty. We'll save... Think of the money we'll save on spraying water onto him. You'll turn up not no sweat at all. What, we're going to have to spray him like an ordinary actor?
Yes. Things are understandably tight in all the Warner Brothers franchises. Yeah.
No, I bought this from Harry Potter World.
Which is
notebook, because I don't like Harry Potter, so I bought the Slytherin.
You don't like it?
Yes.
Oh, right.
I don't like it, so I've got the enemy of Harry Potter.
I've not actually read it, so I don't know what it involves.
You haven't read the Harry Potter? Did you watch the film?
I did. I did. I went with some friends to the cinema in Swiss Cottage, and they made the mistake. I hadn't told them how tiny my screen time would be, so they went, "Way!" when I came on and missed my entire performance. And bizarrely, I think there was someone else with an equally small role in the film in the same screening, because about an hour later, a similar group of people the other side of the cinema suddenly went, "Way! Oh, sorry, Ian, sorry." Yeah.
Mainly I've got you on because I want to talk to you about the children's television show Balamory, which is definitely the best thing you've ever done and ever will do, let's face it.
Yeah, that could be right, yeah.
And the reason I'm quite obsessed with this is kind of slight, semi-tragic... In that, I when it was on about 10 years ago,
yep.
I was drinking quite heavily most of the time. Yeah. And I would often wake up at 6 o'clock in the morning.
To drink?
Well, no, because I was, it just like I drank so much, it always made me wake up and I'd always slightly have the fear. I'd always become slightly, and feeling really, I don't know if you've ever had, I don't know how much you drink, but... When you just get to the point where you wake up and everything's confusing and you're not sure whether you've kind of got to the heart of the world and the world is a terrifying, panic-inducing place.
Yeah, don't know. I think when I set out drinking, I'm clearly less ambitious about what I'm sort of going to achieve philosophically out of the evening. Yeah,
I like to get to the point where I start to see the world as a tissue of lies in a terrifying universe. But at 6 o'clock, to try and come down from this panic attack that I would usually have every day about 6 o'clock, I would turn on TV, and the only thing that was on TV at that time was CBBC.
Right.
And so I spent a lot of time... slightly drunk watching Balamory and Big Cook Little Cook, which to be honest I prefer, and if I could get those guys on I would get them, but I couldn't get them but also the Big Cook Little Cook, the little one is actually normal size, but the big one is like a giant. That's how they do the Special in, effects.
Sorry, in real life.
Yeah, in real life, yeah. The little one is actually 6 foot tall. Yeah. But a big cook.
But,
and big
can,
cook
but can fly, can't he?
On yeah, a, he can yeah. fly. That's special, that's not real. But the other one is actually massively giant, so I couldn't actually physically get him into the Leicester Square Theatre. He's too big.
You can book just one of them.
It's not... That's not going to work, is it? Just have little cook.
Well, not on this budget, but someone could. Yeah.
Good. I think you'd probably book them now. So it wasn't like they were big stars at the time. But anyway, these shows are very repetitive. You know that, I don't know if you know this about your children's television programmes you've appeared in. I went to Longleat, so I just accidentally spat something up out of my mouth there. And it fell onto the floor there.
It was probably just a sort of bit of your sort of residual craziness, some of the old paranoia, even talking about your terrible dark drinking days is beginning to set some of it off.
It was a little bit my liver coming up for air, as it reminded. But they're very...
gasping for air.
Because they're very repetitive. Balamory would... especially Big Cook, Little Cook, but Balamory had the opening song, which... Did you ever meet the kid who sang the opening song in Balamory?
That sounds really interesting.
He couldn't pronounce the word nursery. That's... No, not so many Balamory fans in. The kids at home are loving this. Going to church or to nursery. That's what he says. See?
I feel, honestly, despite the fact that you've never seen it sober,
yeah.
I feel less familiar with the programme than you are. I was never quite convinced what the opening lyrics were. I mean, my own thing, I played, as you remember, the inventor, and the lyrics were, up to the castle, inventing with Archer, he's ever so something, and ever so... And I always wondered what it was. But I clearly wasn't curious enough at any point while we were filming 253 episodes to ask what it was. It sounds, in retrospect, almost as if I was sort of coasting through the whole experience, but I can't imagine that had been right.
But it's very popular with in Longleat, in the safari park.
With the animals.
The gorillas.
It calms them down, yeah.
The gorillas have TVs and they love... kids' TV because it's repetitive and they like the colours of stuff, which they would love in your show, because again that was
it was very brightly coloured.
You were in pink, you wore pink all the time.
I did, I lived in a pink castle. Everything about it was basically to change the way children see the colour pink.
Yeah.
It was sort of superheroes can wear pink too, kind of alpha male butch guys, people you wouldn't mess with, people that the sort of people you turn to if you were in trouble on the bus, that sort of person can wear pink.
So I don't know if I enjoyed it on a different level to the kids that watched the show.
I shouldn't have thought so.
No. It was quite mind-blowing, but I did become quite obsessive with it. Did they ever find... I watched them all. They never did find out what the story was in Balamory. That was the... My theory is that you're all in purgatory and were waiting. It was kind of an odd situation you found yourself in.
I think already you've spent longer thinking about this programme than the people who own the format and dreamed it up, Richard. But yeah, the whole thing was an analogical programme. Yeah, it was about purgatory. It was about social issues. For instance, I was a sort of laird in it, so I had inherited wealth. I lived in a castle, PC Plum and Miss Hooley. That's the state sector. They lived in bungalows. It was all... It was about understanding how economics works and what's... many of the things that are wrong with society and we could change, and many of those things that aspects of society that can't change, sadly. Yeah.
And do you have the phone number of the first Josie Jupp? And if not, more reluctantly, do you have the phone number of the second Josie Jupp?
How rude you are. I don't know. Just, you know, that thing when you go and you get a new phone and they say, can you put all the numbers? I don't know how to do it. Can you put the numbers? And they go, yeah, we put them all on the new one. And then about 6 months later, you go, half the bloody numbers have come off. So having changed my phone however many times since I did that programme, which was, 10 years ago, Richard, although I've never lost interest in it, I think at some point I have lost those numbers. Yeah.
I am only going to talk about
Buki
Balamory. I think I should lay my colours on the mask now. They're pink, and I'm going to.
Yeah. Well, I'll become quite the live wire.
Young Ben Evans has a couple of questions about it. Hello, Miles Jupp.
Hello, Ben Evans.
Or should I say, Archie the Inventor?
Ah, you got me, Ben.
You ruined my childhood.
Yeah.
None of your inventions worked. Any new projects of yours?
I ruined his childhood because none of my inventions were. I think that's yeah. He wasn't a great inventor, but also the other thing about his inventions, he's sort of lying. A lot of things that my character invented in that program were things that were already commercially available. And then we'd stick a bit of black tape over the sort of trade name so that there was no sort of infringement. So if he couldn't get the things to work that are commercially available in shops, then I sort of worry for his future in a number of ways. And likewise, if he attempted to copy everything that my character... I don't, to be honest, have the statistics to hand. There's an awful lot of information about this programme I seem to have forgotten. Yeah. But what a sad story. But I'm sorry to have ruined his life.
Okay.
Insofar as I have.
A follow-up Balamory question. We nearly threw all of his questions now.
Oh, really?
What is your favourite character on Balamory? Not yourself!
Now, is that your italics?
This or is, yeah. He says, not yourself.
Edie McCready is my favourite, yeah. There you are. Do I have to show my working, or am I allowed just to be confident?
Like, yeah. Edie McCready, who drove the minibus around. She was
the bus driver, yeah.
I can't remember your song, to be honest. All I can remember is climbing up a magical ladder.
Painting and I just can't stop. Yeah, that's Spencer. Yeah, Spencer from Rod from Las Vegas. Yeah.
Good.
There you are.
Seems like my audience isn't as interested in Balamory as I am.
Not just your audience, Richard.
we'll talk about something else. But it seems a shame.
You could sandwich it. Throw some more questions in at the end.
I'll move on. I know when I'm a defeated man. Your dad, interestingly, because you play a lot of vicars and stuff, your dad is a vicar. He's a United Reformed Church minister.
That's right.
Some kind of vicar.
Yeah. Minister. Sort of chilled out congregationalist if you're into denominational delineations, Richard, and I suspect you are.
I am. See, my dad was a headmaster. He was my headmaster.
Yeah.
So was it having a dad as a minister, was that, did you feel under pressure to behave well as a child or be religious?
At times, yeah. Well, we definitely go to church every Sunday and Sunday school. In fact, I sort of used to think it was unfair sometimes. I mean, my brother and I, we would go to church every Sunday and then there'd be sort of prizes at the end of, I don't know, the academic year or something. And I remember my brother and I winning the regular attendance prizes. At Sunday school, or even at the time, thinking, "Well, of course we did. We haven't. This isn't. You're not rewarding us for our own initiative and efforts here." But it's also that thing. People assume members of the clergy are sort of very easily shocked and stuff. You're in some play or some sort of student improv show. Oh, don't say anything rude tonight, Miles. His dad's here. Oh, he'll be terribly shocked. But people that work in that line of work, they're not easily shocked. They have to be sort of bleak, difficult things, like someone from the police knocks on the door and says, there's a family down the road and the dad's just been killed and I don't know how to tell them. I've only been doing this job for 2 days. Could you do it? And he goes, yeah, okay, and goes and does it. Or someone says, can you visit my uncle? He lives in a DOS house and we haven't seen him for 4 months. And so he goes and does it. So there's an element of that where, you sort of think they're sort of slightly more aware of real life than perhaps are portrayed in Derek Nimmo sitcoms.
Plus, the Bible's pretty full of sex and violence.
And anger. And
God's pretty nasty.
Betrayal,
So they're used to it. Once they've read the Bible, the real world
pales into insignificance.
Compared to God's anger and the stuff he gets. So those plagues of locusts and stuff he sends.
Yeah, or do you think it's a plague that you've been visited upon here in this theatre? You're constantly attacked by insects.
We're ready for
tennis players.
Got this as well. We've got a spray. Mm-hmm. That's more long term, I think.
Listen, if something turns up that needs to be killed, I'm very happily would kill an insect on your behalf, Richard. I feel, I would take on that mantle relish.
But we've been lucky so far. There was only been one midge. And last week it was proper full on, 2 weeks ago it was proper full on blue bottles. I've got it. This is another thing that's a bear bug of mine. You're on Celebrity Mastermind.
Oh, yes, yeah.
Yeah, and you won Celebrity Mastermind.
That's right, yeah. And you're. Have you been on it and not won?
Yeah.
I didn't know you could go on it and not win.
How many points did you get?
27 or 8? How many did you get?
35.
You got 35 and you didn't win. Yeah. Who are you up against?
I don't want to talk about it.
How on earth? You must have been up against some absolute...
It was Hilary Kay from the Antiques Roadshow, and she chose Chippendale as her specialist subject.
Oh, yeah. Right. And what did you choose? The Chippendales.
I chose Rasputin.
Right.
Which I didn't know how to... I had to learn all of it because I couldn't speak Russian, so I had to learn everything phonetically.
Were you on Russian Mastermind? Why did you have to learn... You can learn about Rasputin without speaking Russian.
You need to be able to say all the Russian names. I had to be able to say the name of the street he was on, though later I found out I could have used the English translation, which I didn't know. Poproskovsko or something it was. Second. 15 minutes to say it.
I think you did well to come second. Did you come second?
I did come second.
And who did you beat off?
what's his name, the footballer?
No idea. Even if you say it, I won't know.
And some actress remembered it. It was an actress, you know, I'm not going to beat them.
Yeah.
unless all the questions are about themselves. And a footballer who didn't know anything about his... I want to say Alan Hansen, but it wasn't him. What was his name, the bloke that I was on Sledge Mastermind with? They're useless to today's audience. They don't know any facts. What was your specialist subject?
It was the cricketer Michael Atherton.
Ah.
Yeah.
What is Michael Atherton's middle name?
Andrew.
Don't know if it is, but...
Of course, I had to learn how to pronounce that at the time. I wouldn't have heard... Wouldn't...
But you see, I am much better at Celebrity Mastermind than you, but I don't have a trophy. You see the injustice in that? And
yeah.
I'm so annoyed.
Well, I don't think of it as injustice. I mean, you know, it was fair and square.
I just need to get 27 points. I'll take my foot off the gas.
No, I just chose something deliberately that I already knew lots of things about, yeah. Such as the language that people generally tend to talk about it in. And then I did a little bit of... there's only two main source textbooks about Michael Atherton, and I've devoured... and I've already devoured them. Yeah, yeah. I enjoyed it, though. I think I was on with Rachel Riley from Countdown.
Wow, she's clever, though.
Yeah.
Did she do maths? Did she do hards? Did you do sums involving the numbers 75, 150, 25?
You'd hope. No, football or something. I mean, it was all swimming before my eyes. I was fairly... I don't think...
I still dream about it. I had a terrible... I need psychological counselling after it, seriously.
After it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I had a dream where I was...
Oh, you can't go on Celebrity Mastermind and expect yourself slowly to no longer need psychological counselling. Richard, that was never going to help you as much as that. No, people do it mainly for profile rather than the effects it will have on their mental health.
Where do you keep your Celebrity Mastermind trophy?
I don't know. I would.
So you don't. That's what doesn't. If I had one, it would be enshrined somewhere. Special. It would be. I'd made a special.
Would you? Do you want mine?
No. I don't want it, but I deserve it. That is.
Yeah.
bastard.
Whoa, is this aimed at me? Is this... I can't believe the form that your jealousy is taking, Richard. I literally, it was just the luck of the draw, to be honest. 27 points was enough to win that day. You don't hurt me.
Okay. You got lucky this time. I only have to be lucky once. That's right, I was quoting the IRA. Well spotted. So that's what the IRA said when...
Brighton bombing. Yeah. No, I've done the reading. Yeah, that was... It's things that I was told that I'd need to know about before coming on this show. Richard's obsession with Balamory and the IRA.
I don't approve of most of what the IRA did, but no. That was a fucking cool thing to say. But it proved out they were wrong. Mrs. Thatcher defeated them because they were never lucky. They didn't kill Mrs. Thatcher. They said, you were lucky this time. We only have to be lucky once. That is the coolest thing a terrorist has ever said. And I'm including Osama bin Laden in that. When he said, fuck yeah. I knew those things would go down. The audience today do not like me being offensive. They really don't. Yeah, usually my audience, like, I think I've got some Miranda fans have come in. And maybe some Rev
no,
fans.
No, it's fine. No, okay. It's fine, really.
Maybe some Balamory fans. Oh, no,
yeah,
definitely
no, I suspect.
Not. And that it's not... Shall I, if I get my shirt ripped off, will you forgive me for the David Frost and IRA-based jokes that I have done?
If you get... They won't. What, What's that a reference to?
Earlier on I made a joke that didn't work about a sick joke about David Frost.
Oh yeah.
Don't worry. Right. So you, I've lost them. You're gonna have to get them back. You have recently, been in John Stewart's film that he took time off to. Is that his name? Yeah.
Yeah, John Stewart.
John Stewart, yeah. From America, The Daily Show.
That's right. Yeah.
You've been in his film.
Yes, it's called Rosewater.
Yes.
It's about Iranian elections. I went to Jordan. This was great. I went to Jordan for about 3 or 4 days. To film one scene in which I had, I think, 3 lines that was set in London. but then I got to go and do that. It was absolutely fantastic, yeah.
Which part of Jordan did they use to double up for? Was it in a studio?
A man, yeah, it was an interior. Wow. It was an interior shot. Yeah, they don't have a sort of miniature Houses of Parliament there that you stand sort of quite far away from, and it just sort of... we've just got to sort this out a bit because it's a bit complicated, the maths, but do you know what? Stand near it, then it will look... No, hang on. No, come. No, it's not. It was an interior thing, and you know, it's one of the many. As I learned when I was working on the Harry Potter franchise, you know, you can make the inside of one thing look like the inside of another thing that's also inside. And normal people don't know that, but film people, we know that. We understand how that works. Yeah.
So, did you meet John Stewart in real life?
Yeah, he's the director of the film. Yeah. So he'd have to be. I'd have to be really up myself. I'm afraid I don't speak to the director. I've done the audition. That's how I intend to do it. Any notes need to come via my people, handwritten, please. No, I make a point of introducing myself to the director, so I know who to believe. And he's a very nice guy. He's got that sort of Armando Iannucci quality of being the sort of effortlessly being the sort of funniest guy in the room all the time. And he's a massive cultural figure, John Stewart, especially so we'd run into Americans if we were out somewhere, you know, at a hotel or something. And, you know, people would just see him and get very, very excited. And then we filmed one day here in London, somewhere on an escalator in the City of London.
Didn't have any of those in Jordan?
This was one that really needed to look like it was in London, and I had to film it. This is sort of boring if you don't like cricket, but it was the first day of the last Test match of the Ashes, and I'd had a ticket for 9 months or something, and then I was going to do the film the day before and then go to the Ashes. And the week before, my agent rang up and said, "You're going to hate this, but you've got to leave the cricket to do a movie." And I thought, do you know what? That is annoying, actually. But if my teenage self heard that one day you'll have to leave a test match to go and do a movie, I'd have thought, that is almost as good as being in Balamory.
Especially if the movie was on an escalator. I loved escalators when I was a kid.
But you've got your nerves gone now. You just can't you can't get the enjoyment out of them. I'm never sure if I'm going to go up or down them. It's an absolute minefield.
I've got a very strong memory of being quite young and being I was quite brave when I was really little, and I lost my bravery entirely. And I was quite little, and I became obsessed with escalators and jump and playing on them, getting up to them. And the, you know, the leap you had to make to get on them, it was quite scary when you were little to make that first leap to get on. And if you're from Somerset and seeing a moving staircase.
Yeah, yeah.
So it was like being in Harry Potter before Harry Potter existed. And I remembered playing on an escalator, and then a man from the shop coming furiously saying, "Stop playing on that escalator," and really telling me off.
And is that one of the phrases that's in your ricochet? When you wake up after a terrible evening on the booze, is that, "Stop playing on the escalators, Richard"? Is that one of the phrases ricocheting around your poor, rotting head?
It is. Yeah. You should have let me play on that.
I got on an escalator with two of my children somewhere recently, and I hadn't before taken them both on an escalator, and I was sort of thinking about how this is going to work as I approached it, but forgetting, because it's a moving thing, you have a finite amount of time to make that decision, and I got it wrong. I got onto the escalator with my daughter, and then I turned around and put my son on it, but of course I was moving away from him. I could no longer reach, and he was standing on his own at the top of the escalator shouting at me, and I didn't. I basically had a sort of panic attack of the sort that you're worryingly familiar with, but luckily a nice gentleman said, "I will help him down," and so I took his hand like a sort of deus ex machina, and the moment was saved. But for about 35 feet I was the worst parent ever.
It was like Sophie's Choice, basically, what you had there. Which kid Which kid am I going to stab? I'm going to leave my daughter here on the escalator, go back and save my son, or leave my son behind?
This is what they enjoy, Richard. They enjoy the literary references, not your love of terrorists. Yeah, this is more of this, please. That's what this noise is saying.
I don't love terrorists. I just sometimes appreciate some of the things they say. And a few of their occasionally more inventive terrorist atrocities also enjoy, like when they put bombs in breasts. They haven't done it yet, but it's my idea. If they do it, it's my idea.
If they do it between this being recorded and this being released,
yes,
you will sound like some horrible, sort of nasty, unpleasant soothsayer, won't you?
Yeah, sort of. Have you ever been to a fortune teller? Because I was talking about being to a fortune teller. Because I've had two, because I've had another experience. I've got a saint that looks after me. I also have a red Indian looking after me. I would have said Native American. I'm quoting the woman who's... I was going out with an actress who was quite spiritual and into crystals and
This anecdote would work better with a name. Who was it?
It was Julia Sawala.
Oh yeah.
And I have done it in one of my shows, so people would know that. But she's quite into homeopathy and crystals. I'm kind of... She believed in fairies, genuinely believed in fairies. I'm not.
Well, she went out with one.
Hey!
Hey! And 25 minutes, I'm warming up.
we got a long time, don't we? We can be here until they are really laughing. We're still. Then that laughter was just them trying to make it end, but that one doesn't count. That was a false laugh. She's a very lovely person. Mm. Me and her didn't really get on in the end, it turned out, because I'm very rational and she's very spiritual. I'm 95% certain there are no fairies at all. I like medicine when I'm ill. We went to... We're doing a Tai Chi lesson together. Which is... I must have loved her, because I've never done one before. It was just the two of us, and the woman said, "I can see spirits from beyond the grave." And I said, "Oh, that's good. Well done. That hat probably comes in handy. Be good on this show," because that's one of my questions. And then she said, "I can see your spirit guide." And me and Julius Wilder had the same spirit guide, who was a Native American called Running Bear. Yeah, right, I was a bit embarrassed. It's a bit cliched. And he'd been watching over us, and he'd brought us together because he knew we were soulmates. Which is nice, isn't it?
Right, that must have been reassuring.
Yeah, but I'd fancied Julia Swire famously for about 10 years before I went out with her, and we worked in the same job. You'd think any spirit guide trying to get us together could have done the bit quicker.
Could have just,
us together straight, like a fortnight, I would imagine it would take to engineer that.
Well, maybe if it hadn't been for his intervention, it would have taken even longer for her to warm to the idea of going out with you and allowing you into her life and indeed exercise classes.
Yes. But also, we weren't soulmates because we didn't get on and we split up about 3 months later. Why did Running Bear bring us together?
To spite you, essentially.
He did.
Because he was tired of being referred to in a sort of politically incorrect fashion.
Well, also
fortune tellers, and thought, "I'm going to make a point about it."
It made me wonder why so many spirit guides are Native Americans, why they're helping out Europeans who wiped out their culture. It's like they're either very giving and forgiving, or they're just doing it so they can bring together inadequate, incompatible couples.
Well, I suspect the latter, based on the rather small amount of evidence we have in front of us. When I was at university, I did theology, and I had a job, not a job, I did a placement as a hospital chaplain. That was basically a module you could do. One term you did a course of theology in practice, in which you'd sit in a room and talk about how people might behave in a sort of religious environment. And then there was a sort of... They went, "Do you want to do the practical one?" And that involved actually going to a hospital and being... So I just put my name down for it. And actually, where it was, I was sent to be a hospital chaplain. Not a real one, obviously. I mean, I had a badge on that said student, but to be a... They were like, "Okay, now listen, none of these guys know you're not qualified, so just put this on, say what you like." No, it was proper, real thing. But I was sent to a psychiatric hospital, and I would have this badge on that just said student. And I would go into one of the wards, and they would just say, "Go in and talk to people for 2 hours, and then come out, and we'll have a sort of chat about it." And I had a slightly bizarre conversation with them, with the main chaplain there. He says, "Is there anything you're worried about?" It, and I said, "Yeah, I'm on." At the time, I was still at university. But I was doing this program we did in BBC One Scotland called Live Floor Show, which was a sort of
you know, gang show with Frankie Boyle and the Reverend Obadiah and people. And I said, yeah, the one weird thing is, although I'm doing this during the day on Friday nights, I'm in this television program, and I just wondered if that will cause any difficulty for the people on the ward, if that would be confusing for these people. And he goes, well, what is it? And I said, well, it's a sort of comedy program, and we do stand-up, and I do this sort of character and stuff. And he listened to it, and he went, to be honest, it really sounds like the sort of thing they just wouldn't watch. which was, you know, possibly fair. But then I would go, and there was the same guy I talked to every week, and I'd go and I'd think, I don't know why you couldn't. Some people were clearly very depressed, and wards were arranged very bizarrely. They were arranged not by what age you were or how ill you were, but literally just by postcode. So everyone that lived in a particular postcode, irrespective, they could be from the age of 16 to 64, male or female, would be in the same ward. It was the most underfunded hospital in Scotland, hence their desire to get in student chaplains just to soak up some of the weirdness, I suppose. And I would go in and I'd talk to the same bloke every week, and I used to go home thinking, I've literally no idea why he's in this ward. I don't understand why he's been in a hospital for 15 years. And then I went the next week, and he started talking about rays coming through the window and the need for the, God, they've just not put enough foil up. We're all going to be taken by the rays and stuff. And I thought, oh, right, that's extraordinary. Then he told me the reason why he was in the hospital, which I can't tell you now, but genuinely terrified me. And then having finished that story, I was sitting there thinking, oh, my God, that is absolutely terrifying. And he went, anyway, I'll tell you something else I can do. I can tell you what age you're going to die. Do you want to know? And I said, I don't actually. And he went, well, no, it's 88. So... No, you don't need to look so worried.
That's pretty good. That isn't so terrifying, because I think by the time you're 88, you've probably forgotten about that as well.
Oh, well,
so it won't be like living the whole of the 88th year going, oh, it's coming any second.
Yeah, exactly. No, I'll have relaxed, but I'll probably be mainly spending my life at sort of Balamory conventions, answering questions that mean even less to me then than they do now. Yeah, and what? I mean, that's not a bleak vision of the future. In any respect.
I like the idea of in a hospital chaplains, you know, going around like student doctors all together in a big group of hospital chaplains with one going, so what's spiritually wrong with this guy? And all having to suggest things.
They sort of go around like sort of Avengers Assemble kind of thing, and they sort of all, each one's from a different denomination. Yeah.
So you did. So are you still religious?
No, my wife's Catholic, and we go to church often.
Right.
It's mainly Sundays.
Yeah. But you don't. You're not a believer yourself.
I do. I do sort of believe a bit, but I've got no sort of structure to it all. What I'm particularly keen on, though, is the idea of religion and that sort of side of things. And what really irritates me is sort of the kind of professional atheism. I sort of think, well, look, if you don't believe, just fuck off and talk about something else. I mean, it's not, you know, that kind of sort of arrogance of assertion. I find that sort of stuff. Now, I know you've made horrible sums of money talking about how little it means to you, but that sort of thing, I sort of think, well, just shut up. So I would like religion to win that battle with those sort of braying people like Dawkins, who sort of goes, yeah, can I have loads of money to stand in a variety of hillsides going, religion's rubbish! And Channel 4 whoever go, yeah, go on. And then lots of comedians going, God, he's amazing. He just says a thing over and over again, which I know is popular with some comedians of your generation. I'd like religion to win that battle, but I don't want... I don't think it's a basis for wars. You know, I don't want that... That side of it, obviously, it's all gone too far.
Yeah. They should all calm down.
I would describe myself as moderate in almost every respect, essentially.
But it's fascinating. I think religion is part of the reason it's a lot of comedians cover it, is because it's it's fascinating. I'm very interested in religion, so I do read about it a lot.
Yeah.
And I'm not, you know, I've come to the conclusion that it's probably not right or real.
Yeah.
But I also think you don't know. But I think as long as you're discussing
I think with Christ on a Bike, which was the show that I did most, you know, my religious, it was a lot of the religious people came to see it were impressed by the academia behind it and the study behind it.
Well, it's great,
But it's, you know, but I think that's a fascinating thing to talk about. I think the problem for me, I think the reason comedians are drawn to it is because it's a closed system of thought and people are saying you have to believe this. And I think for me, and presumably for you, you were brought up in an environment where, you know, if you challenged it, you got into trouble.
Well, you know, not really. No, right. I think it was always quite sort of relaxed in that regard. And I'm always amazed when you see it doesn't really, people wouldn't do it now, but you know, sort of 10 years ago on the circuit, you'd say someone going, "Oh, I don't know, I'm imagining we're about to do this in an Australian accent, but that's not, that can't necessarily be right." But just that sort of thing going, "Oh yeah, yeah, religion. Oh yeah, sorry if there's anyone Christian here, and you're going to be offended." And you think, no one is about to be offended by your half-baked idea about fucking whatever it is. Do you know what I mean? I think people that. But ration versus belief is a sort of difficult thing because belief is belief. It's a leap, isn't it? Whereas reason is based on, you know, a number of steps. So I think it's an argument that is what's good about it from a commercial point of view, from those purveyors of doubt, is that the two things aren't compatible. You can't win an argument about a thing if one side's coming at it rationally, one side's coming about belief, because they're just it's two different systems. Yeah. It's like
I found,
margarine arguing with you know, clouds. I mean, it's just they're not from the same pool. It won't work. It won't happen. You couldn't have a sporting fixture between clouds and margarine, could you? Well, maybe you could. You could probably get a podcast out of it. I know you've got basically no unpublished thought. You would have to do that. Yeah.
I found the people who complained were the ones who had never seen it.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, that's...
So the people who picketed it and said, you know, this is wrong, refused to actually watch the... interesting, just as we're talking about religion, that fly's come back.
Yeah, yeah, well, that could be anyone, mate. I'd watch... Oh, wow, you are...
Can you hear the swishing? That's what's exciting.
I knew a lot about you, but I never knew how sporty you were.
I am. I can play a bit of tennis.
But people do that. But people love to be offended, and I think people getting offended is the most irritating thing. I mean, I think people take great delight in being offended by things that are nothing to do with them, and it's just a kind of attention seeking.
Yeah.
Oh God, I feel so good. I'm offended on somebody else's behalf. I must be such a good person because I read this thing in the paper that someone's not been particularly nice about another thing. I don't quite know what it is. I've never read any books about it. But anyway, they were being a bit negative. And do you know what? On their behalf, the people I can't quite remember their names or what it is they believe in. But I found myself incredibly offended on their behalf. And I must be great. I must be a very compassionate person. That's what I must be. And people that just spend their lives being gleefully offended about things that they don't really know anything about are, I think, they're sort of almost the some of the worst people in the world. They're almost as bad as the terrorists whose ideals you so espouse.
All right, I'll ask you. I've got a new emergency question. You may have heard it if you were listening backstage. And it still works for a man. Would you rather have a tit that dispensed talcum powder...
Mm-hmm.
But every time you touched it, talcum powder would.
Every time
out.
I touched it, yeah. I don't have any control over it.
And every time you squeezed it. So if you brushed against it, a little bit of talcum powder might just pop out of the nipple, but you'd have to give it a proper sort of honk to make. But you would also have a breast, the only one, as a man.
Listen, I fluctuate, to be honest. Okay. I can imagine that being all right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Or a finger that can travel through time.
Yeah.
Which of those two things would you prefer?
Well, I can see... God, it's hard to choose between them because they both have so many attractive... the talcum powder thing. I know a lot of people, it's not fashionable anymore, but I've always enjoyed... As someone that's always spent... And I've never really mastered drying, to be perfectly... To be perfectly honest, you know the thing when you go to the swimming bath and you've been swimming for 45 minutes, but afterwards you think, I've been getting changed about an hour now. I cannot... What have I done? My genitals are still soaking. I've dried them and then I've got a bit hot. It's a bit muggy. Why have I got the thought that I would be able to sort of turn myself up into a ball and just sort of empty a tit onto my... of talcum powder onto myself, just sort myself out. I would relish that, to be perfectly honest. And I imagine quite a lot of other people would say, God, do you know, could I have, could you just squeeze some of that onto here? Because I cannot, I'm completely dry. I haven't been in the pool for 4 hours now. I'm completely dry, but I cannot, the inside of my legs is absolutely, I don't know if it's leftover water, I don't know if it's sweat, but I cannot dry. Can I? So I would happily dispense talcum powder to other fellow sufferers in this regard.
You might end up
regard.
Just staying in the swimming pool changing rooms for your whole life, though. You'd never be able to go. You'd start doing it for one person, then someone else would come and say, like, can I have a bit?
Oh, yeah, but I wouldn't. It's not a 24-hour... I mean, eventually I would be asked to leave. It's not a 24-hour, you know...
It's most of the day, though.
Yeah.
A lot of your, you know, working time would be taken up.
It would be taken. Yeah. Would you like to go for this audition for this thing? It's very exciting. Listen, I would love to, and that is actually one of the two accents I can do. But there's a massive queue at the Peck and Pulse, to be honest. And there's people just can't get dry today. I think it's because it's quite humid, essentially. So I will make more people happy by just staying here. So that's clearly a very attractive thing.
If you had a finger that could travel through time, I thought of another thing you could do. Is you could... has that woman managed to travel through time to know that it was going to be something... It wasn't going to be something disgusting. I've thought of another thing a finger can do that is not rude.
Oh, right.
You could dial, like, a phone number on and make someone ring... the wrong person as a kind of prank.
You could be.
Go through and then they'd pick up the phone. And then you go boo, 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 and then they're talking to someone different.
Oh yeah, that's
be
a good
like
idea.
Churchill could ring up.
Hitler.
I was trying to think of someone else, but yeah, and go, we surrender. I know you could make him do
yeah,
that.
Yeah, what? That's a great ambition, Richard. Yeah. Not because of out of any malice, just out of a general academic interest to see how different Europe would be if we'd surrendered to the Nazis. It's not. I don't mean it out of spite. That is essentially what you're saying, isn't it? I can see what you're saying. You're being completely objective about it. It's not because of any sort of political sympathy on your part for the ideals of the Third Reich. It's simply from an academic point of view. And I think, I think you're probably being less offensive than you sound. Yeah.
Okay. And have you ever tried to suck your own cock?
No, I haven't. No? And I think that's because I've got a fairly sound idea of how inflexible I am.
Yeah, but you have to find that out at some point.
Well, even just attempting to sort of touch my toes, I realised just how far short I would find it. I've not attempted to, but obviously you've sort of piqued my curiosity.
Do you want to try it now?
Yeah. Well, is this the platform? Is this the direction I want things to take? I haven't even answered your question about. Although I was.
Oh, you haven't. Sorry, no.
I think with the finger thing, I suppose it'd be quite useful. Basically, if you've, I don't know if you experienced this, but I'm one of these people who sort of regret things that you've said previously. You could go back through time and basically just sort of shush yourself. You could back to be sorry, some sort of appalling thing, you know, those sort of things that you say as a teenager that you're sort of sitting in a restaurant or something 15 years later and you sort of go, oh God, what, oh God, what a dreadful thing to say. They're probably thinking about it now, aren't they? Those, oh God, everyone else from school probably meets up and goes, God, do you remember that time he said that really offensive thing about, oh. So it'd be quite nice to be able to just sort of basically, but then that's sort of censoring your own.
It is,
past,
and would
isn't it?
The younger you know, you would know now, you'd know from any time that you had the power to do that, but would the younger you know what this finger, they'd just go, what's that? And
there is something
the finger,
really
go, what's
wrong.
This disembodied finger doing in my face?
Yeah, that's true.
And
yeah,
then
yeah.
That might, you know, but then you would just go ahead and say the next thing. You wouldn't think that must be my future self instructing me to be quiet.
Yeah.
And well, would you listen to yourself? That's the other question. I wouldn't listen. If I went back in time now to 16-year-old me, I wouldn't listen to this old idiot telling me what to do, saying, you know,
well, you'd probably
work with Stewart Lee. I'd go, I'm going to work with Stewart Lee.
Well, is that what you'd say to yourself?
I'd say, don't work with him. You'll just nick all of your ideas and pass them off as his own.
These
fuckers.
What is the nature of your relationship with Stewart Lee?
It's a very strong.
Is it a strong? Because I never, because you know, because you're quite jokey. I never, when you say things about Stewart, you know, yeah. I never know what you really. I mean, what? Because I mean, right. I mean, he's very good, isn't he? He's very, so there's that. So you presumably enjoy that aspect of his
he's
work.
He's really good at the one thing he does, which is why I really appreciate that one.
Yeah. Well, that's better than appreciating nothing. I'm sure he feels that more keenly than anybody. But you genuinely don't get.
No, we're very good friends.
Oh right. Oh okay. But see, now I don't know if you're. If you're joking and if you're
I'm very hard to read. Imagine being married to me. It's a fucking pain in the arse.
Yeah, no, I mean the elements of it. Yeah, yeah. What, do you lie in bed just shouting about Stuart Lee? She must lie there thinking, to be honest, I thought you'd mention him sometimes, but I really didn't imagine it would end up being like this. I mean, I suggested we make love half an hour ago, and you're just going on about similarities between he's said and things you've said. This is some of the romance is draining out of this relationship.
Make her put on a Stewart Lee mask, to be honest. She doesn't mind, she likes it.
Oh, okay.
I know, I'm delighted with his success, and I wish him more.
But what? Yeah, that would be sort of different for people that listen to the audio version of this, and then people that watch it, well, they'll get a very clear view of your.
That's why I'm giving the extra value to the people who are paying.
Yeah, there's people that listen to this that have no idea you've got a twitch. constantly roving hands. What else would you say to your 16-year-old self apart from the sort of Stewart Lee?
I would no,
advice?
I would definitely. I wouldn't change all that much in my life. Mm-hmm. I think the good things and the bad things are important, aren't they? I think if you didn't make the mistakes, it would be, you know, things would turn out differently. And I actually think most of the mistakes I've made in my life are definitely my own fault.
Yeah.
But I think I had to make those mistakes to be the fantastic person I am. I now am. The balanced person I am.
Yeah, yeah.
I had to spend 2004 watching Balamory with a hangover, still drunk.
Yeah, yeah. If it hadn't been for those sort of experiences you'd had, yeah, there's no way this podcast would have had such a blinding opening 20.
We lost him a bit on the Balamory.
I think that year of hell was definitely. You watch that spike in the downloads. I think you'll find it worthwhile.
You have to think of the audience beyond the room sometimes. You know, there's maybe 200 people in the room here. Mm-hmm. At home, there might be 250 people listening.
Yes, so absolutely.
Some of them will be the same ones who've listened here. But they'll appreciate the second.
They've edited out that thing about the Nazis. Why have they done that?
We should have laughed more at that. Why are we having a go at lovely Richard Herring? Just because he says some stupid rubbish. His mind won't stop pouring out shit. Oh, I nearly stopped there for a second, ironically. Do you ever worry? I worry this week because I've been tired and running around a lot.
Yeah.
I haven't really been able to think of any ideas for anything.
Worry about things.
Do you worry it'll just dry up for you?
Yeah, that's a sort of fear, I think. Yeah. You need, sometimes you get an appointment, you sort of literally put yourself on the clock. Like I'm doing room 101 tomorrow, and someone rings up, you know, months ago and says, what would you put into room 101? And you think, oh God, today's the day they're ringing to ask what I'm putting in room 101. And oh God, I'm looking after the children. And you sort of reel some things off. And then you put the phone and think, I've just given them about 8 things. I can't remember any of the things I've said. And then like 2 weeks ago, you get an email saying, remember you're coming tomorrow, bring a shirt. By the way, the things you're putting into room 101 are this. And you think, why do I hate those things? Oh God, now I've got to think. First of all, I've sort of got to sit down and think about why I hate them. And then I need, if I can some way of distilling them into some sort of pithy remark that will make the edit of a thing, then that's all to the good. So you sort of basically, I actually enjoy that kind of pressure about things. I think the blank canvas is the scary thing. Whereas one of the reasons, I know a lot of people have begun to hate them, and I think one of the things I like about panel shows is actually working within certain parameters or whatever. It's not you're not showing looking at a blank sheet of paper and going, right, I must write some jokes. What can I write jokes about? I'll write them about, all right, what's that? Oh, traffic. I'll write some, no, traffic's dreadful or whatever. Whereas someone goes, oh, you've got to make jokes about the Conservative Party conference or something which one would normally have no interest, then you can sort of get on with it. So having to write a certain sort of thing about a certain subject actually
for me, is a way of preventing things drying up. Otherwise, yeah. I'd just end up sort of pissed and screaming at children's television. Yeah, it could easily happen.
You're not even as old as I was when that happened to me yet. So,
is that right?
Yeah, I'd have been about 36. You're still younger than that, aren't you?
34 I am. Yeah.
You're a young man. Got your whole life ahead of you.
I've got specifically 50. What have I got? I haven't got the maths for it. 54 years, yes.
Yes. That's a long time.
I was really frightened when that happened, I have to say, because I sort of thought, no, don't, whatever he says, you mustn't believe it. And then, so I was sort of prepared for him to say, you're going to be dying the way home today, or something like that. And then he said 88, and then I thought, well, no, I can't take that as well. God, maybe I'm going to die on the way home. Do you know what I mean? Once he'd brought up the subject of my death, it was hard to relax.
If you really believed it, then you could live a sort of supernatural life where you walk into fires and save people from, because I'm not going to die till I'm 88.
Oh, yeah.
You could go and just be, I'd be living my life as a superhero if I was you. I'd be jumping off buildings.
What I now realise I missed off the end of that anecdote was the 6 or 7 day period I have of extreme confidence running in front of buses and setting fire to myself and trying to sort of lift people up and jump in between buildings, which ended with a lengthy stay in the institution where I first had the thing. Yeah,
but all these fortune tellers always play tricks on you as well. So you could do that, you'd probably walk into a fire and then you get really badly burnt up, but then just be in a coma until you're 88 and then die. So you have to be careful. Play with fate.
There's many ways of skinning a cat.
Yeah, well, it didn't work. My fortune teller was very bad, so you know that. But that doesn't mean then they're all bad.
No.
Some of them might know the future.
Some of them are very good and deserve to play to bigger audiences, I think. I have to say, I really,
you sort of said talcum powder.
I hadn't really said it. Yeah, but I mean, even now, I would think talcum powder was a good, you know, a good Christmas present. If someone got some, if I. You know, I remember I was young, I'd see my dad open certain, people gave him the same presents, he'd go, oh, I don't use this, or whatever it was. I would, you know, even now, if I thought, oh God, talcum powder, I should always have talcum powder, I can take this swimming, whatever it is. I'd be, if anyone, I mean, you're probably already, October, you're probably already thinking about what to get me.
But now you'll
have a better idea, some terrorist-themed talcum powder.
But I thought you were going to give your dad some talcum powder for your Christmas from your tit.
But of course, you'd have to say,
this is tit talcum powder, Dad.
Well, what I do it like people that give olive oil and stuff like that. You know, you put it in a nice bottle and you say, this is olive. These are olives that we've squeezed ourselves. Well, I'll be able to say, well, this is you know, talcum powder that I've squeezed myself from my soul breast. I would have a lovely label on it. I'd probably put it in some quite nice old jars that you get from the sort of, you know, nice reclaimed furniture shop or something. I think, God, actually, I've got to get quite busy at the moment, but I'm going to put aside some time. Oh no, I don't have the magic tit. That's what I need, isn't it? God, I'm so excited about this idea. I've actually allowed myself to believe that it's real. It's a genuine possibility, like winning a prize on a game show or something. Oh my God, I turned up. It's a great podcast. It's really fun. You get to chat to Rich, and you don't get a fee as such. But I left with a breast out of which came talcum powder. So it was a very worthwhile experience. Yeah.
Good. You've been in a film directed by George Clooney.
Yes.
Did you meet George Clooney in real life?
Yeah, he's another of those really off-the-wall directors that insists, and this is quite arrogant, actually, but in being on set and watching what's happening on the monitors. I mean, he is... That's why people say the guy's out there. He directs it, and he's in it. It's quite... Well, it's ludicrously exciting, actually. It's a Second World War film. I play a guy called Major. I'm sure you could imagine me playing a sort of an army officer.
I can.
I had about 90 auditions playing different American characters, and eventually they went, could you do an English accent? So I said, gladly. It's called The Monuments Men, and he goes, and him and Bill Murray and Matt Damon and...
Wow.
Do
you meet them?
No. I met... Although the day I was on set in Berlin, we did it, and John Goodman he was clearly bored at the hotel, and he just came wandering around. So I found just him being there sort of exciting, really. But yeah, we had this sort of film about art,
people saving art and stuff during the Second World War. It's very cool, but it's very difficult. I mean, someone, I got very nervous about it because I thought, well, he's George Clooney, the whole thing's going to be tremendously pressured. And I sort of woke up really early and I couldn't sleep before. I thought, God, I must keep running my lines and having breakfast going, I'm just running my lines. It would be so high pressured. And you get there and actually it's just people just at work, just sort of getting on with it. And they all know each other and they're not, he doesn't sort of rule with a rod of iron. People aren't terrified, they're just doing it. But it's very, you know, you're chatting between takes and all.
Yeah,
you know, actors just like hanging around talking. So I'm talking to the other sort of British guys going, isn't it cool? Isn't George Clooney cool? And then suddenly he sort of wanders out with an apple going, hey, what are you guys talking about? Can't say, well, we were talking about how cool you were. So you sort of going, we were all discussing about, you know, he's just trying to think of it. We were discussing which airports we were all going back to when we left Bolivia, some sort of dreadful thing or whatever. And then he, you know, he's very chatty or whatever, so he'll be telling some anecdote about having a fundraiser for Barack Obama at his house where, like, Barack Obama's security people had to build a special sort of chemical-proof shield inside the shower in George Clooney's spare room. He's probably got several spare rooms in case of a chemical attack and all these things. Or, oh, yeah, we were playing basketball one time or whatever. And you're sort of thinking, well, you know, I can't just offer nothing in return, sort of thing. And you're sort of thinking, I wonder, gosh, I could tell him about, oh, yes, that's right. There was that time we were doing Balamory live at the NIA and they'd given us the wrong keys for the dressing rooms or whatever like that. You know, he's this sort of extraordinary man, so you feel slightly sort of ashamed of existing, despite the fact that he's, very charming.
Do you have his phone number?
He absolutely wouldn't let me leave without taking it. But shortly afterwards, I got my phone up.
Yeah, he lost it. If you see him again, could you ask him if he'll be on this podcast? Do you think he would do it?
I'm amazed that he wasn't one of the. I mean, I was asked on this reasonably late. I'm amazed. I must have been further down the list than him, surely.
I haven't asked George Clooney yet.
You've not asked him?
No.
Oh, right. Well, yeah, if I see him again.
Yeah. I think he'd be good on this. What do you think, people? Do you think he'd be? They'd like George Clooney, to be honest.
Yeah, well,
so
I can understand.
You know, that's not a vote of confidence for George Clooney.
Yeah, I'll explain to him the setup and whatever. Yeah. I'll say it might be worth thinking about, you know, things you've said in the past, George, or how easily you find it to dry yourself. He's basically perfect, though. He's probably one of those people that gets out of the swimming pool and dries himself, and it's fine. You can literally put a pair of pants on within about 5 minutes of getting in the pool. He's not like me, sort of still sitting in the changing area going, bloody hell, they've been doing exercise for 45 minutes and I still haven't got my fucking pants on or whatever. But I will ask him, and if I see Bukola Agbabiaka or Keisha Haddad, I will ask them to come on this as well.
Don't know who they are.
They are the two Josie Jumps.
Oh, okay, cool.
The TV version.
They're not real?
Richard, really Josie.
I thought they had to get the second person called Josie. The reason I assumed the second one wasn't as good as the first one was that they just had to get someone else called Josie Jump to be it.
Well, I can't really continue this conversation if that's the basis on which you're making the assumption that I can't be part of the discussion.
I'm joking. They were both really good. They were two of the best actors in Balamory.
Yeah. Well, it's yeah.
And there was some tough competition.
You could say anything you liked about that. People have said all sorts of rude things about my work in that programme, but it's hard to mind. Kevin McKidd, who's in, what's he, is he Sick Boy?
In Trainspotting.
Yeah. He said to me, or maybe to Miss Hooley, in the Scottish BAFTAs.
I like Miss Hooley.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I have got her number.
Yeah.
He said, I was watching that programme the other day, and I don't think I've ever seen anyone in a programme ever appear to give less of a shit. Which, you know...
He hasn't seen Big Cook, Little Cook.
Yeah,
seriously,
yeah.
Big Cook just doesn't even try to act.
Or the video version of this, to be honest. That may finally put that one to... Put that one to rest.
We both care very deeply.
I found it very flattering that he said that, to be honest. I was delighted he'd seen it, having enjoyed his...
You ask Frankie Boyle to unblock me on Twitter?
Why has he blocked you on Twitter?
I don't know. Can you ask him why he's blocked me on Twitter and then ask him to unblock me on Twitter and I can ask him to be on this podcast?
Is that what it's all for?
Yeah. I want George Clooney. Listen. I looked through who you knew.
Yeah.
I thought John Stewart, George Clooney... Frankie Boyle. It's the triumvirate that everyone wants.
Yeah.
Josie jumps time.
You're just using me for my. It's ludicrous to think that I would have more contacts than you. I mean, you've been going for centuries.
I'm really bad at asking for people's numbers and stuff. I was at a thing with Joe Brand this week.
Name dropper.
And I really wanted to ask her to be on this.
Yeah.
And I knew she couldn't do today anyway, so it wasn't.
Yeah, you clearly knew a lot of people couldn't do it.
A lot of people. No one could do
it. Oh, yeah. God, what is it? 7 o'clock on a Saturday morning? This will probably be someone wondering if I want to do a podcast on Monday. That's the way that most of the prestige gigs kick in. Yeah. But why is he writing in capitals? Please help me. I've been up all night. Everyone I like has blocked me on Twitter. I think Balamory is real. Will you help me? Will you help me? We could talk for an hour. It's unprepared. When the show finishes, hold me. Never stop holding me. This message was sent from my handheld device. Yeah, it was all good. It was all good.
But anyway, I couldn't ask Joe Brand. I don't have Joe Brand's phone number, and I was too embarrassed to ask her. So that's why I'm not very good at getting people. I'm so amazed I've got anyone to come on this podcast.
Oh, right. Well,
So I know you, so I felt like I could ask you to come on.
Yeah, okay. Well, I'm still happy to be here, but I'll ask. I'm also happy to make any number of overtures on your behalf, Richard, to people that you're scared of or are George Clooney.
I think if George Clooney came on, I probably would be. I think I might say something embarrassing.
I think you'd probably prepare some questions.
I've got loads of questions. So, here's a question. Think that finger thing wasn't prepared?
Yeah, right, yeah.
Want to see it written down?
Yeah, no, I'm being completely unfair. Sorry,
people enjoy this. You were in the Imp Perverts at Edinburgh.
The Imp Perverts,
which I imagine is a group of people who do have perverted sex with imps, which I imagine is quite difficult because imps will pretty much do anything.
Yeah.
So you were at the Improverts.
That's right, yes.
Which a lot of people have done. It's an Edinburgh University thing. It's an impro group.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. People like the Penny Dreadfuls. I don't even know. Tom Tuck, David Reed, Humphrey Carr.
Reed supports York City. He's a good guy.
That's right. Lucy Kirkwood, who wrote Chimerica, that's on at the West End, which has had the best reviews of anything ever. She's part of that gang. Yeah,
never heard of her.
All sorts of people.
Do you think you get her on the podcast? I've never heard of her.
Yeah, well, I'll open with that line and see how long a conversation it turns into.
Jenny
Richard.
Colgan, the authoress.
Jenny Colgan, she must.
No one says authoress anymore, do they? That's not right.
Authoress, no, they don't. She must have done. You know her, don't you?
I do know her.
Are you too scared to ask her?
No, she's not. She's not in the elites like you, Miles. Only 26 people have done this before you, or 27, 28.
Okay. Well, that's.
So there's a lot of people to get through.
There is.
Before we get on to those two.
I'm going to be exhausted doing all my ring rounds. But yeah, listen, write a dream list, and I promise you, when I'm not busy, I will put a lot of effort into booking this up, because I'd hate the idea of you sitting here talking this filth to an empty chair. That's almost as depressing as 2004. Yeah,
it is. I've moved on a long way since then.
Yeah,
I'm relatively happy now. I wish I had some talc, though. I'm really sweaty. I feel like I could get the part of the weatherman in Harry Potter now, only if we could travel through time.
I actually brought some napkins on from I went to a restaurant earlier.
Oh, you did,
And they gave me some napkins in case I found the healthy food they'd given me. And I put them in my pocket before I came out because I thought, I bet I'll sweat out there. But for whatever reason,
you haven't sweated.
I felt oddly becalmed by your presence. why don't you mop your brow? Because I think if people are watching the visual version of this, the glare, it will look like I'm being interviewed by some sort of Christ figure.
We don't have makeup people. We can't afford makeup people on this show. So it's, it's every. I think we've all relaxed. I mean, the audience have relaxed to the point. They're in a coma.
Yeah.
We have to try and drag them out of that before the end of the show.
Let's shake it up with some crazy shit.
Okay. Have you ever seen a ghost?
I haven't seen a ghost, but there's two things. One, I remember very clearly. This must mean I have a sort of a silly memory, because I have a very definite recollection of thinking, oh my God, I've seen a ghost. But I cannot remember what happened. It's odd, isn't it? I think it was in Cornwall. I've got such a vivid recollection of thinking, I have seen a ghost. I can't believe I've just seen a ghost, but I cannot, for the life of me, think what this apparition was that I saw, if it was an apparition, that made me completely convinced that I'd... But I can't... I really did think I'd... I can't think what it was, but I really did think I'd seen one. So I must have done.
Do you ever remember thinking, oh my God, I've just seen a Bigfoot?
Yeah, I've just seen a big sort of creature emerge from the lake or whatever, or lock. And also, the Stand Comedy Club in Glasgow is thought to be haunted.
Oh, is it?
And there's lots of stuff. I'm sort of on the board there. We have meetings, and every now and then it's one of the things on the thing. This certain society that's interested in ghosts wants to come to the club. And I did have an experience there once where I was on stage. And you must have played that room.
Yes.
It's a really great room, and it's sort of, you're on one of the long sides of the room. And I had this. I was quite convinced that someone had walked across the stage behind me, and I thought, well, that's probably just someone going for the toilet. It's a bit rude, but you know, I'm mid anecdote. I'm not going to risk improvising. That could ruin everything. And then they came back again, or whatever. And then one time I came, they weren't making a noise. But you know that thing when someone's walking across a floor that you're standing on, and you can just feel the floor dipping and rising. I became so, the person, or whatever it was walking really slowly, so I thought, I don't really, well, I mind a bit people fucking walking across the stage to go to the toilet while I'm on, but to do it this slowly is really rude, actually. And I sort of span round, and there was sort of no one there, so I felt a bit sort of weird about it. So you don't, one of the things I think when you think you're sort of just about got a Glasgow audience on side isn't going, has anyone else seen a ghost? There's a goat, because you sort of think they'd think this guy's, he's lost it, it's all been a fluke up to now. But I looked around, there was one person in the audience, I sort of looked at him, but he looked back at me, and I went, was that a thing? And he went, I really don't know what that was, in quite a sort of haunted manner. But he might have just been playing along nicely. He might have meant, what was that you were doing? How could you... This isn't an act, this is someone just saying things they probably thought as a teenager and imagine it's satire now or whatever. So it's my act was for about a decade probably. So that I haven't seen a ghost. I turned around thinking I was going to see something. I didn't see one.
Yeah.
And I'm really certain I saw one earlier in my life, but I don't know what it was.
Yeah, that is the definition of not seeing a ghost, isn't it?
No.
It is. You've just told me an anecdote that is about you not seeing
a ghost. Oh, that is not... That you're right. Yeah, one of them is.
And
but
so
the other
I asked
one,
you if you ever seen a ghost, and you told me an anecdote that was about you not seeing a ghost.
Sorry.
It's like you're being willfully abstract and
obtuse. Do you know what? I don't know what I'm thinking, because before I came on backstage, I said, what sort of thing are you after? Yeah. And you said, can you give very direct monosyllabic answers to all of the questions? It's really annoying when we go out there for like an hour and a half and everyone... You know, God, last week we had people on doing anecdotes. We had people just sort of winging it a bit and getting ideas and running with it. And, you know, the whole thing ends up being sort of relatively amusing. And what I really want, I want a really concise, factual 15 minutes when people can listen to it and they go, yeah, I know what that man definitely thinks about four or five subjects. Yeah. So sorry, I've let you down in that regard. No, I've never seen a ghost. Use that in the edit.
You would just edit to that. You've on your Wikipedia page, it says that you've been
Right. This is almost definitely not true.
Okay.
I've stopped looking at my Wikipedia page because a friend of mine used to put such ridiculous things on. I thought it's more fun not to look. And then when I'm doing a sort of interview on some local radio station or something, they'll ask me a really weird question, and then I'll know what's on my Wikipedia page.
But okay. Well, is this true? Because I didn't... Well, just it struck me as an odd thing to put on the Wikipedia page. You've been described as... Your friend described you as Harold Meeker from a Rent-A-Ghost character. You're Harold Meeker from Rent-A-Ghost character.
That is... There's a guy, Nick Finley Coulson, that I used to write with that every now and then goes and... And I've tried to get in contact with him a number of times recently, unsuccessfully, but he once spent a lot of time amending my Wikipedia page, including saying that I'd played a sort of homosexual psychic in CSI Kilmarnock and things like that, and like listed like a really long discography of solo albums that I'd recorded. There's something, I don't know if it's still on there, but I had a week when I did three different panel show recordings. And each of them, the sort of bit, because that's the sort of rhythm of how you introduce people, each three in a row, the joke they had was based on the fact that my hobbies were fly fishing and tea tasting right, which are not hobbies of mine, right? And they never have been, but someone blew puts this up on my Wikipedia page.
Yeah.
And it's got to the point where, you know, that writer's room or whatever, they go, what can we... Oh, right, yeah, oh, brilliant, he likes that. And so you just sit there whilst a sort of very well-respected sort of satirical organ tells however many million people that, you know, you really like tea tasting or fly fish or something. And I just sort of let it go. I mean, I'm sort of quite happy with this.
It's self-verifying kind of... then as well, that's the problem. So if it's on that programme, they can then link... Citation needed. Bang, there have I got news for you.
Oh, yeah, you're right. Yeah, that
he
must be why...
He didn't challenge it.
That must be why it's still there. Yeah.
So the Harold Meeker thing isn't... You've never...
I don't even know who he is.
I know, well, it's very... Harold Meeker... again, this is going back a little bit. I used to love Rent-A-Coaster when I was a kid. It was one of my... There's Bob Mumford, who was the funny one. Most of them are dead. He died, the character. Ironically, they are mostly all ghosts. Harold Meeker is still alive. He looked like the oldest one. He was the man who... I don't even know. He was the landlord, I think, of the thing. It's just, he was quite grumpy.
Right.
He was in it all the way through, but it's very hard to pinpoint what his character was. So I love the idea of you being called a Harold Meeker character.
That sort of famously vague man who's, only bright side is that he's alive. Yeah. Well, I mean, if it's about grumpy, I am a very grumpy man.
Yeah, well, maybe.
One of my favourite things is Frasier, and the reason I got into Frasier when I was at school was a friend of mine saying, there's this program you need to see that is about two people that are just like you. they probably are a bit, yeah.
Well, I'm getting tired, man. I tell you, some of us have run a half marathon. You could carry on talking, but I don't know if I can carry on.
I think without the structure of your question, this would become a very disconnected hour.
I'll ask a question.
I mean, the backbone, you know.
Could I ask a question and have a little sleep?
Yeah, go for it.
When you've finished the question, just hit me with that tennis racket.
All right, yeah.
And electrocute me away.
Can I do that? Oh, yeah. Yeah, okay.
How much did it hurt?
Not that much.
No, they do hurt. I used to live in a flat share and we had one of these. And Al, my flatmate, thought it was really funny to wait outside the bathroom and try and... sting people on the bottom when they came out. It was fine for me because I had such an enormous sort of talcum powder shield. Nothing to get through, but other people suffered greatly.
Yeah. Yeah. Did you ever try and put your penis into the thing to see what that would feel like?
Yeah.
let's say I did.
And I remember the first time I did it, I immediately thought, you know, once is not enough. I have to do this several times a day.
Were you dressed as Archie the Inventor when you did? Because you had a kilt on, you could easily get in there. Let's say you were. Let's put it on your Wikipedia page.
Yeah, yeah. You're desperate to get back onto the Daily Mail sidebar. No.
Because Tinky Winky from
Dave
Teletubbies.
Dave Thompson.
Who was quite a perverted man.
Is he?
Yeah.
Right. Well,
he did some awful things. We'll get him on one day and see if he'll talk about the awful things.
He's a really nice guy. He's really funny.
He's a very nice guy.
Yeah, very funny man.
But he's a disgusting pervert. He did some awful things in that Tinky Winky costume.
Right. Well, I'm sorry to hear you think that. My mother's a lawyer. I know some really helpful phrases.
I don't think they can pin that on you. It was definitely me saying it.
Well, that's what I'll say in court. It was.
What is it like being Miles Jupp?
Who wrote this question?
Ben Evans.
Ben Evans. What's it like? Well, I quite enjoy lots of it.
Yeah.
I work reasonably hard.
I go to community exercise classes.
Did you generally miss, you said you were having to miss some boxing?
Oh yeah, box fit I go to.
It's yeah, really on Monday good. Nights.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you could go Monday, Tuesdays, Wednesdays, Thursdays.
So it's right. You haven't missed
a boot camp
week.
On Saturday. I'm going to go Wednesday. I can't go tomorrow. Okay. But no, looking forward to that very much.
I kind of thought it was some kind of IKEA thing when you first said it. It took me a while to realise. Like oh, yeah. Box fit, it sounds like you're going to make some stuff in a...
I'm amazed that having finally, after sort of 11 hours of constant emailing, someone came back and said, yes, I'll do it. I'm amazed you read to the bottom of the email and you weren't just dancing naked around your own home shouting, at last, at last, at last, at last, someone's replied to one of my emails.
Oh, they all replied, Miles.
Oh, right. Oh, right, yes. Well... no, it's sort of quite nice. I have a family and I eat and can afford the mortgage. And,
Have you ever tried to kill yourself?
Have I ever tried to... Oh, I see, right, yeah, yeah. Is this...
Yeah, this is... It would just round it off nicely if just something tragic happened, because then people would have to go, oh, it was good.
It was good.
It was really, good at the end when it was
yeah,
moving.
Yeah, really nice
end.
Ending, because there were times when you genuinely thought it was going to go nowhere, but then... And he told that story about being a prisoner of war. I'd forgotten that war. It was I mean, that whole generation, forgotten war. No, I've not tried to kill myself. I'm sorry if you want this show to have some sort of recurring theme. I'm sorry that that's
you want to try
unable to help you.
Try it with this.
No, I really don't. I have been got by one of those, and I do not envy the life of a fly.
The perilous life.
Being me is perfectly nice. That's what it is.
That is nice. It's good. I don't think you will probably in 2 years' time be waking up watching children's TV drunk but hungover and howling at the moon.
I hope not. Yeah.
You never know. Things can happen in life. But hopefully.
I don't have a television, and we've got really quite bad broadband. So right. it would be hours into the day before I was successfully managing to actually.
You don't have a television?
No, no.
Wow.
I'm just no.
But you're on television, you don't have a television.
Well, you say I'm on television, I don't know.
Anything could be happening.
The whole thing could be an elaborate sort of... what's that film called with Jim Carrey?
The Truman Show. Don't get me onto that at this late stage.
Oh, right, that's an excellent...
That's terrible fucking load of shit. The only film worse than that is... Yeah. What is everyone?
I've got them
as a cult. Yeah. They all believe, they all agree with me now that the worst two films, Sliding Doors and The Truman Show.
Oh, really? Yeah.
Truman Show is slightly preferable to Sliding Doors.
Yeah, I'd sign with you on that. That's amazing, he just hates Sliding Doors.
Yeah. And so does all of the people. How do they all just say that at once? If it isn't the worst film ever.
You're right, that is, I mean...
You think, people talk I got about... these people together, prep them and say, if at any point we get a start... Miles mentions The Truman Show. Can you all say that Sliding Doors is worse than that? Yeah, are you insane? What's wrong with you?
No,
that is scientifically proven.
That is the most empirical evidence I've ever had the good fortune to be on the wrong end of. Yeah, I quite enjoyed it. I didn't. No, I did. I did quite enjoy it. It's got an incredibly awkward bit where he's doing Monty Python and they're all laughing, haven't they?
Oh, Sliding Doors.
Yeah,
That is the crux of the... of the badness of it, because I spent my whole life reciting Monty Python sketches.
Oh, right.
Nobody ever wanted to get off with me as a result of it.
Is that
nobody?
True?
Yeah, I mean, I was a kid, as a teenager, I was obsessed with Monty Python. So I would have been that kind of guy going, nobody, he doesn't even do it very well. At least if he did it well, someone might go, oh, I'll give him a blowjob out of pity. Well, Gwyneth Paltrow's not going, oh, look at this guy, he's so amazing, he can recite someone else's comedy. That's what women really love. Not a guy who's funny, a guy who knows Monty Python off by heart.
Yeah, I can see why it doesn't hold up in that in that regard.
Tom,
yeah.
You know Monty Python off by heart, don't you? Yes, you do, stop lying.
Wow. What? God, so I didn't realise it was a thing. I thought you just didn't like it because it was not a good film. Rather
and it
than
is it, not a good film as well.
Rather than it being something that reminds you of yet more painful periods. There is no part of your own inner psyche you won't happily mine for material. But then what? This is probably, you've probably done about nine podcasts today, have you? You've probably written a blog, judo with yourself whilst describing it. Written for the Metro? Do you still write for the Metro?
I do, I've written a Metro column today.
What was that about then?
It was about
the stuff I've talked about the fortune teller and the it's fresh on my mind.
Oh, right, very good. I enjoy reading the that column.
Thank you.
Yeah, well, I thought... I was reading it the other day on the train, and I thought, he's done well. Someone's bought a suit. Yeah.
I get criticised for my suit.
By who?
Someone wrote into the Metro to complain about how...
What, and they pass it on to you?
They got printed in the paper, on the last page. And then someone offered to make me a suit because of that, and I refused.
Oh, really? Because you should have just said, yeah.
Why not? I just felt awkward about going to someone, a man saying, I'll come to my house, come to my shop, and I'll measure you and make you a suit. I just thought that could lead in all kinds of horrible direction.
Welcome to my tailoring dungeon.
Yeah. And then I've got to write about his suits, haven't I? Sometimes, like when I wrote about Mr. Kipling, they sent me a pack of French fancies or something. That's all right.
Yeah.
But if someone makes you a suit that's worth 500 quid, you've kind of got to go, well, by the way, thank you very much. What's his terrible suit?
Yes, I can see life. God, life is a succession of agonising decisions. I think it's a lovely suit, and I think you look very smart. Yeah,
thank you.
Anything at all. An emergency question, something weird. I mean, literally.
Well,
anything.
I had the tea tasting and fly fishing. That was.
You're joking.
I had it written down with the Harold Meeker bit because that seemed a very suspicious bit.
Yeah, that's particularly, wrong.
If you had to ask a celebrity guest an emergency question, what emergency question would you ask them?
That's a very good emergency question. I'd say. Describe the work of Stuart Lee in no fewer than 100 charming adjectives. No fewer than. Who's going to go ask that? Have you booked next week's?
Next week it's going to be either the... Well, it's on the... It's Dara O'Brien.
Yeah,
because that's got. I don't know why I thought the way I went for Ahmed, who's been on it before. Dara Breen and Ross Noble, and okay. not. Why did I go for Ahmed Lily? What's gone? My brain's broken down.
It's all that running and.
It is. It's not, I'm very, very tired.
It's hard to run 13.1 miles whilst eating fondant fancies, and worrying about what you wear, and simultaneously podcasting.
I'd forgotten I had a stick of licorice in my pocket.
You never? Now?
I did, no, during the run. Oh. It was very good. Mile 10, I remembered.
Out it popped, did it?
Yeah. It was very nice. Do you have any unusual phobias?
I would rather it was really, really hot and it slowly melted inside. And someone running behind me going, that comedian in the white shorts who writes for Metro has the most worrying stain.
Well, there was a point straight away afterwards where a little boy... It was very odd. There's a little boy who was too young to read, I would say, and I had my name written on my shirt. He said, well, go on, Richard. And I go, how did he know my name? Can he read? He obviously wouldn't know. I doubt he was a fan of my work. But then I was really worried. I kind of went, hey, to him back, and I thought, I probably have really black licorice teeth and have terrified that child for the rest of his life.
Yeah, well, he's probably a big fan of your work.
He might
probably,
be.
Yeah, he probably reads... His dad probably brings the Metro home for him at night. I brought the Metro home for you. It's the one with Richard's collar in.
Have you got any unusual phobias? You better have one, because this is the last question and it's got to be brilliant. And if you haven't got one, it's going to make the podcast look ridiculous.
Any unusual...
It has to be an unusual phobia.
I absolutely... You know when... shops in their windows, they stick up stuff that sort of advertises what they do. For instance, a news agent might have a sort of montage of some newspapers.
Yeah.
Right, or kebab shop or something, or a delivery vans, they might have photographs on it of things like lettuce and tomatoes. Essentially, photographs of perishable items that are definitely now no longer exist.
Yes.
Makes me absolutely sort of shudder. So walking, there's a kebab shop near me, and the window there's like pictures of tomatoes and lettuce and meat and stuff that's goodness knows what state it's in now. It's, probably long beyond compost. So the sight of photographs of something fresh that I know now is no longer in that. There's a sort of, what's the Oscar Wilde thing, Dorian sort of grey thing. Yeah. You think that lettuce can't look like that now? It's been on the window for 3 years or whatever. That, I go, oh, God, it's the bloody lettuce. So that must be a weird phobia, I'd have thought. Is that weird enough?
Yeah. That's definitely weird enough. That is the best yet.
I'll be driving along and we'll overtake a sort of brakes lorry or something like that. And I'll go, oh, God. And Rachel, what is it? Have you locked the back door? What's the matter? I go, oh, look at the brakes van and whatever. Oh, lettuce, it's disgusting. That would be, God, it won't look like that. It would be rotten. I'll tell you, it would be rotten. The photographer probably ate it and he shat it out now. Imagine driving that lorry. That's disgusting. Having to look in your wing mirrors and seeing lettuce on the side. Oh, God, disgusting.
So you're afraid of the transience of living matter.
Yeah.
So if you see a picture of a long dead person, do you think, oh, no, they're probably a skeleton now? If you see a historical photo?
Bizarrely, no. It seems to be mainly just, not people, but just perishable shop goods.
Yeah, because you imagine you have to eat it now. You imagine you go into the shop and they'd serve up.
Yes, is it? Yeah, exactly. It's a weird dream. I'd like the lettuce you've got in the window, please.
Oh, somebody's come for the lettuce. And they'd come upstairs, there'd be just some appalling thing that's sort of just brown and covered. This is the lettuce. And it can't be. The lettuce in the window is beautiful. This is the lettuce.
Yeah, so that's, for me, I find that frightening. Was that the sort of thing you were dreaming of when you woke up?
That I've been going 1 hour 35 minutes. It's amazing. We've done very well.
Well,
it's like running a marathon. It's like running a half marathon. Some people can do it very fast and efficiently. That's kind of easier when you think about it than running for 2 hours 37 minutes and 41 seconds. There were people like, I was halfway around. There were people who were back home having a cup of tea already.
Yeah,
that's not impressive, is it? I ran for 2 hours, 37 minutes, 41 seconds. That's a fucking feat of endurance.
Yeah, exactly. No, they
and
are.
This is what this has been like today. may have been other interviewers might have done this more succinctly. We may have got to the points more quickly, but no one has done an interview as long as this.
No, it's really about the journey, isn't it?
Well, can you please give a big round of applause to my lettuce-fearing friend, Miles Jupp, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Come and see We're All Gonna Die. It's in here for the next 6 days. Thank you very much. Goodbye. How'd you like them sky potatoes?
What a lot of fun that was. Haven't watched it, can't remember anything about it. Chris Evans, not that one, said it was a good one. Not the one from Captain America. The one from Go Faster Stripe. He said it's a good one, so I can't remember anything about these once I've done them. I'm not even sure they've really happened. I'm not sure I even exist. And maybe I don't. I might be computer generated. That was a little glitch in the matrix there. I hope you enjoyed that. Be back next week either with a brand new Rahulastapa or a retro one if we haven't got that together in time. Remember, if you go to gofasterstripe.com/badges and donate £1 or more a month, then you get lots of extras, including a little bonus 5 minutes backstage with the guests every week. And lots of other interesting content on there as well. You get a badge and your money goes towards creating new series of internet stuff. Hopefully we'll do a new As It Occurs to Me with your money in 2016, a monthly videoed one. That's the plan. So we'll try and do these things without your help. You don't have to give any money, but if you give money, that will speed the process along and show us that you love us. We're very needy here at the Richard Herring's Leicester Square Theatre Podcast Enterprises Sky Potatoes. How'd you like them Sky Potatoes? Goodbye.